Let's get to the legal angle of this, because, of course, it is complicated here when we're looking at what exactly it's all going to mean. Let's bring in our guest who is standing by, Lisa Jean Helps, criminal defense lawyer. Lisa, thanks for taking the time. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me, Todd.
Okay, so walk us through it here, because, you know, you've been following this closely, and it's difficult to sort of get a sense of what this might potentially mean. Here's what we know. Not guilty plea, a deferred prosecution agreement. This all going on virtually at a court in Brooklyn, New York. Your read on what it all means.
Well, a deferred prosecution agreement in the United States is one where the prosecutor, in essence, grants a type of amnesty. And the exchange is that the defendant agrees to fulfill certain requirements, which often mean corporate taxes, pay fines, implement corporate reforms, do things that go to the heart of what the problem was with the conduct in the first place. So a deferred prosecution agreement in a case like this generally means that the not guilty plea that you heard your first few guests talk about is not unusual for a deferred prosecution agreement. It's a way of solving the matter without there being an adjudication of guilt, in essence.
Yeah, so what is that? Yeah, just walk us through that, because that's what I find really interesting. The idea that, you know, Ms. Meng pleads not guilty, but there could be some admission of wrongdoing.
There absolutely will be. For a deferred prosecution agreement, there needs to be either an acceptance of personal responsibility or an acceptance of corporate responsibility. So it's a way of pleading guilty, in a sense, without pleading guilty and having the ramifications that come from that.
Okay, now, what happens next here? Where does the case go? Because, you know, this is happening virtually in the U.S., but, of course, you have overlapping jurisdictions. You got the United States. You also have Canada as well. What do you think we might see in the hours and days ahead?
So what I'm expecting is the reason that there's a court appearance at 2 o'clock here will be because once the prosecution is satisfied out of the U.S., there's no reason for us to have any kind of responsibility under our international treaties. So the way that extradition is carried out is a treaty process, in essence, where we have a treaty agreement with the U.S. that if someone commits a crime, that's a crime in Canada, and they are in a position to say this is definitively the person that committed this crime in the U.S., then they institute, in essence, these extradition proceedings with their treaty partner, which in this case has been Canada. So what we're expecting to see is that there will be no reason, if she enters into a deferred prosecution agreement in the U.S., there'll be no reason for Canada to have to fulfill their obligations under the treaty with regards to extradition matters. So I would expect that the Canadian government today will, on the authority of the U.S., withdraw the extradition request.
All right. So in less than 3 hours, we have an appearance virtually or perhaps in person. We'll see how that plays out. But in Vancouver, 5 o'clock Eastern, 2 o'clock Pacific, where you are. And then what? I mean, basically, if Canada drops everything that's going on our side of the equation, does that mean that Ms. Meng could theoretically get on a plane to China?
Theoretically, that's exactly what I would expect would happen. Theoretically, what I'm expecting is that the Canadian representative for the Department of Justice here in Vancouver will stand up and say, now that Ms. Meng has entered into a deferred prosecution agreement in the United States, there's no reason to continue with these extradition proceedings. And so for that reason, we are, in essence, withdrawing the extradition request, which will lead to her no longer being on bail, which is why she's on house arrest, which will mean that she can leave the country.
Okay, lots of great information. Here's a tough question. What does it mean for those two Canadian men, do you think?
Well, I'm a lawyer who does extradition almost exclusively, not a person who deals generally with foreign affairs. But I can make a few comments just based on my look at the situation from a justice system perspective. Technically, these cases are not related. Diplomatically, of course, we all believe they are. Mr. Trudeau has certainly said that on a number of occasions. But tying the two cases together may not be as advantageous for the two Michaels as people want to believe. In essence, we have someone who's already convicted in a foreign jurisdiction of an offense. Whether or not we think that that is able to be legally supported is a whole other matter. But because of that, that mention at the end of the sentence that he could face deportation, that left the diplomacy door open a bit. And so when that deportation happens, will be up to the Chinese government and our foreign affairs officials to negotiate.
Hey, this is wonderful information. Thanks so much for walking us through it. As you know, it gets complicated, and being able to sort of understand how it may play out is very, very important for everyone watching.
Well, I certainly can say that I'd like to hope that there's a strong connection between the two, but with what we've seen from China recently with regards to their justice system, I can only hope.
Yeah, it could be a while. Thank you for this. Really appreciate it, Lisa Jean.